Hey, BTB fans, Thomas here. We're doing a, I'm trying to start a new kind of segment. It's the Teach My Friend Tom How to Play 40K. This is my friend Tom. Wave at the camera, Tom. All right. Yeah, say hi and bye to the beard. Apparently the beard is disappearing today. Mason was very unhappy about that. I'm happy about it. He's had it for a year. It's a little intense. Anyway, what we're going to try to teach Tom how to play 40K a little bit. The idea of the segment is we're going to start this first one. We're going to do a kind of an overview. We've got like about 550-ish points on each side. I didn't really count it out. I just kind of tried to make things that I thought were a little bit balanced. Really, the goal of the game is to kind of teach Tom how to play. So, in this segment, we're gonna just play the game. I'm gonna teach him how to play the basic stuff, and then we'll go for future segments, kind of an in-depth on each phase. You know, we'll have one with movement, one with psychic phase, one with assault, where we'll take different units and we'll talk about, okay, here's how you do it, here's some good strategies, here's some different ideas as to how to do it. And we'll do one on list building, we'll talk about different factions. This is just kind of for fun, let's, you know, maybe people will be able to show this video to other friends of theirs that they'll that want to get into this game, and hopefully that it will encourage people to do so. So let me tell you what we got going on here. We have Necrons that I just played in my most recent bat rep. If you'll notice, this is actually the same table we played on. It's actually the same day we just finished. Don't tell anyone. Shh. So Necron Force versus a Space Marine Force. These are some of my Space Marines. I asked Tom which one he wanted to play. He said he wanted to try the Necrons out, and so let's talk about what he's got there. So we haven't rolled for a scenario or anything like that. We'll go ahead and roll for one. But he has 10 warriors, 5 death marks, 5 immortals with Tesla carbines, 1 overlord with a Semper Tempic weave, the 2+ armor save effectively, and a war scythe, and then I give him an orb as well. So he gets his will be backs on a 4+. I guess the reanimation protocol, sorry, on a 4+, and he has a strength 7, ignores armor save weapon, or +2 strength, he's strength 5 base, anyway. 4 wraiths, canoptic wraiths, 1 with the whip coils, and then an annihilation barge. The Space Marine Force has a land speeder typhoon, so a heavy bolter typhoon missile launcher, 5 stern guard guys, just bare bones, they're just regular stern guard. They're led by my HQ is the upgraded version of the Tech Marine, the Master of the Forge, sorry, and he has a servo harness. Then there is a tactical squad that I've split into combat squads. The one half has a sergeant with a power fist and a storm bolter, he's a veteran, with a melta gun. And then the other side has a multi-melta. And then they have a razorback with a las cannon. And I'm using Salamander chapter tactics, just for instance. Okay, so the first thing we do when we've already got the forces, Thomas or Tom, we've already got the forces. So at this point, what we're going to do is we're going to say roll a die for what scenarios we are. We're going to just use the six Eternal War scenarios that are in the rulebook. So go ahead and roll a die. Let's see which one we get.
All right.
So you rolled a 3. A 3 is I want to say it's the scouring, but I could be wrong. So we're going to check a rulebook, make sure we are right. It was, in fact, the scouring, which is 6 objectives. So we'll take turns placing. We'll roll a die to see who gets to place the first one. All objectives have to be played at least 12 inches away from each other and at least 6 inches from the table edge. Now, what's important about these objectives is once we've deployed forces and right before whoever is going second attempts to seize the initiative, which I'll explain in a second, we'll roll to see what each of these objectives is, because they're worth different values. 1 will be worth 4, 2 will be worth 3, 2 will be worth 2, and 1 will be worth 1. And we don't find out until after everything has been played and everything has been deployed. So now at this point, the important thing is if we had any psychic characters, any psychers, we would roll for whatever abilities they have, but we don't, so we don't need to worry about that. So instead we'll roll for our warlord traits. Regularly. In this game, just for simplicity's sake and for the sake of getting the game done and teaching you basic mechanics, we're going to leave that out. And then we'll talk about that when we do like a segment about setup, for instance. So we're not going to worry about that. We're going to go ahead and roll for who places one of these objectives first. So I rolled a 3, you rolled a 2, so I'll place one first, and then we'll come back. Now, when we do that setup segment, I'll talk about the tactics of deploying it. Like I said, this video is going to be very much just an overview of how to play the game. So if anybody has kind of questions of, you know, is wondering why I didn't teach him tactics, it will be because we're doing it in a future segment. All right, so we played the objectives. We got one over here. This was my first one. Tom answered by playing one there. It's, you know, 15-inch difference. I came about 13 this way. He played one way over there behind this pillar right there. I answered with this one kind of connecting the two, giving one in between, and then he just decided to bring it all together. So we have kind of 4 in the center and 1 off of each edge a little bit. Go ahead and roll to see what kind of deployment zone we've got, or what kind of deployment zone. A 3. So a 3 on that is the what I like to call hamburger. There's hot dog, hamburger, and then silliness. Anyway, it's now that I've said it, I'm forgetting what it's called. It's called it's a 24-inch deployment zone on each side, with the short ends of the table being your edge or whatnot. And it's called the I can't remember what it's called. It doesn't matter. People on the internet know what I'm talking about, and I'll tell you how to do it the right way, even if I don't remember the name. So anyway, there will be one deployment zone here and one on the other side. Now at this point, we roll to see who goes first, or who deploys first, I should say, and whoever deploys first gets the choice of whether or not they go first.
Okay.
Their choice, they get to choose whether or not they want. So I rolled a 2, you rolled a 5, so you can choose to deploy first, which gives you a 5 and 6 chance of going first, or you can choose to have me deploy first, in which case I have that choice.
I will deploy first.
Okay, so he's going to deploy first. Like I said, he has from this table, or from not this table edge, he gets to choose. It could be that table edge or this table edge. He chooses, and he has 24 inches up in which to deploy his units, and then I'll deploy in the opposite. So he's going to choose this one. Okay. So we'll draw a line, and he'll deploy his units, and we'll go from them. So off camera, I was telling him a little bit overview of what his units were, and I just realized I might as well tell everybody. There's no reason not to give him a quick overview of what I'm trying to say. All of his units, all of his shooting is 24 inches or less. So first thing is these Tesla, the Immortals with the Tesla, they have one shot apiece, an assault 1 Tesla weapon. It's strength 5, so against my toughness 4 stuff, it's going to need 3s to wound. And they have this special rule Tesla, which means any hit roll of a 6 produces 2 extra hits. And their assault, meaning that they can shoot and then charge afterwards. Both of these other units, the Death Marks and the Warriors, have rapid fire weapons, meaning they cannot charge if they shoot, but if they are within half their distance, they get 2 shots instead of 1 shot per guy. These guys are also troops, so they have what's called the objective secured rule, which means that if they're within 3 inches of an objective, and one of my other units that does not have objective secured, which would be 1, 2, 3, those units, then they get to hold the object. They would hold the objective over those other 3 units, versus these 3 units, which are the same troop choice, having been combat squatted, and their dedicated transport do have that rule. Death Marks have the sniper rule, so they can, on any hit roll of a 6, they get to choose where their wound will go, the wound roll will go. And then if they roll a wound that starting with that guy, or whatever guy they picked, that guy has to make the save. If it is a character, for instance, the character will still get to use the lookout sir rule, though. Also, if they roll to a 6 to wound, it will be what's called an AP2 hit. That basically, it ignores their armor save. They got some sort of chink in the guy's armor. And they also always wound on a 4+, which will not matter because I don't have anything that's higher than toughness 4. So it's going to be the same as if they were used, the same as if these guys, but these guys with their goss weapons. Okay. You have 4 wraiths. The wraiths are a fast unit. They move 12 inches. I think they might be jump infantry. I'm not entirely sure. I don't remember exactly what unit type they are, but they move 12 inches. They ignore all difficult and dangerous terrain rolls, so they're never slowed by terrain. They never might take damage from it. They have 3 attacks base, so when they charge in, they'll get 4. They have 2 wounds apiece, and they have a 3+ invulnerable save. So rather than just a regular armor save, they also have invulns, and they also have rending in close combat. This guy specifically, this model, if he's in base contact during the initiative step in which his opponents strike in close combat, he makes all of them initiative one. I'm sorry. If he's in base contact at the beginning of the fight, they swing at initiative one. That's the right way to say that. Because his whip coils tangled them up.
Gotcha. So
this is kind of your close combat unit. Finally, you have an annihilation barge. The annihilation barge is a skimmer, meaning that it can move 6 inches and act and shoot as if it had not moved. It also has a special rule called jink. So anytime that anybody says, okay, I'm going to shoot at them, you can choose to jink, which gives you a 4+ cover save, but it makes it so that you have to snap shoot, meaning that a snap shooting is you can only shoot, you can only hit on rolls of a 6. Ballistic skill 1 might be only rolls of 6. I don't remember what the exact wording is now. But he has two weapons. He has a mounted weapon underneath, which only has a 45-degree arc in the front. So it depends on the facing of how your vehicle is faced, where his arc of fire will be there.
Okay.
And it shoots 2 shots at strength 6 and has Tesla, meaning that, again...
So the placement of the model itself...
Yes, the facing, we call it a facing.
Okay.
So a vehicle has, you draw an X through vehicles, and if you draw the X through the vehicle, this is a front, side, and rear arc. And they have different armor facings depending on it. Now, they could. In this case, these guys all have facing 11, so it's 11 front, 11 side, and 11 rear, which means that you'll add the strength of the weapon plus a D6 to most of the time to see whether or not you equal or exceed the armor of the vehicle, and that will tell you whether or not you do damage to the vehicle.
Okay.
So the vast majority of my weapons are bolters, which are only strength 4. So a strength 4 plus a D6 is a maximum of 10, so I can't even hurt this thing with my regular weapons. But I do have weapons like melta gun and a multi-melta, and then there's missile launchers here on that guy, and a las cannon, all of which have higher strength. These are strength 8, and this is strength 9, and so they're more likely to do damage. Now, what's nice about your vehicle is it has what's called quantum shielding. So until it takes a penetrating hit, which is a hit that exceeds its armor value, I'll have to roll against it as if it had armor 13, not armor 11. So it's much harder to hit. But like I said, the facing matters. So if, for instance, I'm shooting you in the side, and shooting you from this angle, it'd be the side versus the front. Now, what you never want to do is you never want to have the rear arc open to me because your quantum shielding doesn't work in the rear armor.
Okay.
Finally, we'll go back. Going back to his other weapon armament, he has this top-mounted weapon which has at least 180-degree arc, so it can swivel all the way around like this. That weapon is 4 shots, strength 7, twin-linked. With twin-linked means the first roll you roll, and if you roll any misses, you get to re-roll. And it, same thing, like this guy right here, his weapons are twin-linked. But anyhow, it's also Tesla, so any rolls of a 6, either on the initial roll or with the re-roll, if you had missed initially, will produce an extra 2 hits. So he can, depending on whether or not he rolls 6s, he can really multiply the amount of hits he does, which is really nasty. And his weapon, which is strength 7, would be against this tank. This tank has a front and side armor 11 and a rear armor 10. But it doesn't have any quantum shielding or anything cool like that. It just, if you hit it, you'll need force to what's called glance it.
Mm-hmm.
And fives or sixes to penetrate it. A glancing hit will take off what's called a hull point. And in the case of this vehicle, it has 3 hull points. I'm pretty sure annihilation barges have 3. And there's 2 on this land speeder. I could be wrong about that. It might have 2, but we're not going to worry about it for the sake of this game. Once the hull points number has been reached, the vehicle is destroyed. If you roll a penetrating hit, you take off a hull point, you give it a hull point damage, and you have some sort of other effect. A 1 through 3 on the die roll is what's called shaken, meaning that the vehicle has to shoot snapshots the following round. If you roll a 4, it's stunned, meaning it cannot move, and it also shoots snapshots. A 5 will destroy a weapon. In this case, I only have 1 weapon. You have 2 weapons, so a 1, 2, 3 might destroy the undermounted weapon, a 4, 5, 6, the top weapon. And then finally, a 6 will immobilize it. If you have a weapon that has a value of AP 2 or AP 1, It's a very AP is armor piercing. So all weapons have a strength value, a range, a strength value, and a AP value. If your AP value is equal to or less than the armor value of what you're attacking, the armor not of the tank but the saving throw armor, they don't get an armor save. Now against vehicles, what it does is an AP 2 weapon adds 1 to your die roll, and an AP 1 weapon adds 2 to your die roll. So this is a strength 9 AP 2 weapon. So when it rolls to hit you, let's say it was shooting at you, it would need a 4 because you have it's 9 plus a die roll, so it could be up to 15 total, and your armor is 13 with your quantum shielding. So if I roll a 4, it'll glance you, and a five or a 6 will penetrate you. And then when I roll, if I do penetrate you, I'll roll a die, and whatever I roll, it will be plus 1 to the damage value. And then these Melta weapons are a little bit different. This guy and this guy have Melta. If they're within half the distance of whatever the range is, the range 12 on this guy, range 24 on this guy, they'll roll 2 dice for penetration rather than 1. So it would be strength 8 plus 2 dice.
Okay.
Well,
let's get to...
Yeah, let's go ahead and deploy. So as far as deployment goes, what you're wanting to do is the name of the game is objectives. Yeah. There are 3 secondary objectives that every game has. One of them is called First Blood, which is the first unit that if you completely destroy an opponent's one of any unit, so it would be a unit is a whatever group, infantry or vehicle. So this is a unit. These 5 guys are a unit. Those 5 guys are a unit. These 5 guys are a unit. This guy's what's called an independent character. He's his own separate unit that can join other units. And then that guy would be a unit. So the same thing here. Unit, 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 unit. And then he's an independent character. So he's a unit himself, or he can join other units.
Okay.
And then be protected by them. So there's First Blood. Then there's Line Breaker, which means if you have a unit, the majority of a unit... So number of models, so let's say these 10 guys, you'd need at least 6 of them to be within my deployment zone. You get what's called Line Breaker, which gives you one point, and that's at the end of the game. And then finally, there's Slay the Warlord. In this case, there's only this is your Warlord, this is my Warlord. If he's slain, he's worth 1 victory point.
Okay.
And then each objective you hold is worth whatever number the objective is once we roll to see what they are.
Okay.
All right, so you're going to go ahead and deploy. And keep in mind, one thing that we haven't talked about, you get to pre-measure everything. So you're marking your 24-inch deployment zone, but wherever you play your guys, and this is something that I'll get to do as because I'm going to deploy second, I can check the range on all of your stuff and kind of try to move and try to deploy myself either in or out of range depending on where I want to be. So we'll go ahead and he'll deploy, I'll deploy, we'll come back and talk about it. Real quick, while Tom's deploying, I'm going to go ahead and explain that my Razorback has a transport capacity, meaning that I can fit 6 models inside of it. And then if they're able to be protected and move inside it, and then if they need to, they can get out, or if they're forced out, if the vehicle's destroyed. So it is a dedicated transport of this tactical squad, so I have to deploy either the tactical squad in it, or if I wanted to choose, say, deploy a different unit, aka the Stern Guard, I would have to deploy them outside the unit and then put them in starting at the beginning of turn 1, my turn 1 for the movement phase, which limits how fast the vehicle can move. So I'm just going to deploy this half of the combat squad inside it, and the rest of my guys will deploy on the table. One other thing that I didn't talk about, which we'll talk about in movement, but also matters for deployment, is each unit has to be deployed, which in what's called coherency. Coherency is meaning that at least one model in the unit has to be within 2 inches of every other model in the unit. So, for instance, all of these guys would be in coherency, even though these guys are not. If this guy, for instance, were to be killed, then during your next movement phase, you would have to move in such a way that you would be in coherency again. Another important thing about that is where you deploy certain special weapons, because all shooting casualties, and all casualties in front are taken from what's closest to your opponent. So he has his whip coil guy, and he's already doing it here, and this is the edge of his deployment zone here. But he has his whip coil guy, and the whip coil guy has special equipment. The rest of the guys are all the same, But he has special equipment, and so he's putting them behind two of these other guys here, so that if I were to shoot this unit a bunch, these two guys would die first before he would lose his whipcoil guy. It's a give and take for the whipcoil specifically, because if the whipcoil is not in base-to-base contact, it doesn't actually get the effect of the whipcoils. But hopefully, he'll be able to adjust that when he moves, and these guys' wraiths do have 12-inch movement, so they should have enough to move it as needed. Tom just brought this up off camera. These guys are multi-leveled now. They made it very simple in 7th edition. Your coherency, your coherency can be either 6, I think it's 6, maybe it's 3. It's either 3 or 6 up and down, or 2 across. So these guys are still in coherency even if they're on a different level. Alright, so Tom's still in the middle of his deployment, but he's trying to decide where he's going to deploy his lord. Now, his overlord is what, specifically, the guy he's holding down there in his hand there, is an independent character. Now, independent characters, if deployed with or within 2 inches at the end of the movement phase of a unit, automatically join that unit. So he can put them in basically any one of these units, except for obviously he can't join his annihilation barge over there. It's a vehicle. But he can join the immortals on the end here, or the warriors, or his crypt, death marks, or his wraiths. Now the thing that the lord is decent in close combat, because we gave him a war scythe, and he also has a 2+ armor save. But more importantly, he has the armor save and a resurrection orb. So what he's good at doing is actually tanking some wounds and making another unit more effective. So he probably wants to add him to a unit to protect that unit. Now, like I was saying before, you always take casualties from the front back. So what he wants to do is he wants to probably, if he's going to join the warrior squad, if you're joining the warrior squad, Tom, you want to put him in the front, because he has a 2+ save, meaning that any wounds that I do to that unit on a roll of a 2+ or higher, he doesn't take a wound. And if there's something that I shoot at it that has a two, that has AP2, which I do have a couple weapons that do, you can do what's called Lookout, Sir, because he's an independent character. That means that on a roll of a 2+, one of these other guys jumps in the way, or effectively the closest model to him takes the wound instead. So the next guy in a row would be like, oh, I don't get a save, but it's okay, I'm just a regular guy. And the other nice thing is, because this guy has what's called a resurrection orb, these guys, all Necrons have a special rule called reanimation protocols. And I say all, and what I mean is most of them. The Wraiths don't, and your Annihilation Barge doesn't. But the regular Trooper guys do. And that means that at the end of a phase, as long as the unit that they're part of hasn't been completely destroyed or fallen back, which I'll explain in a minute what falling back is, you put all of them on the side or whatever, and you roll. And for every 5+, that guy gets back up and rejoins the unit in coherency within two, basically anywhere in coherency around the unit. His resurrection orb makes that roll a 4+ instead. So anybody in this unit basically will get back up on a 4+. So, is that your deployment?
Yeah.
Okay. So Tom is deployed across his deployment zone. He's got the Annihilation Barge over there, then his Wraiths, then he's put his death marks in here. His warriors are here with his lord in front, and then the immortals there on the end. So I'll deploy opposite from him, and we'll come back. All right, I've chosen to deploy very centrally here. His guys are all spread out. Now, there's a couple. When we talk about strategy deployment later, I'll talk about the different things that I could do. What I've chosen to do here is be able to react to whichever side when he moves forward. I wanted this guy, this multi-melta, who has he's a heavy weapon, so that means that he, if he moves, he only can snap shoot. So I want him to try to be as close to centrally located as possible. Plus, he's a troop choice, so they are within 3 inches of this thing. They're getting some cover saves from some of this. So, shooting through this, the guy is going to be somewhat obscured. So that guy will get a cover save. Some of these guys are partially behind. Most of his weaponry is AP. I think all of his weaponry, except for the possibility of those death marks shooting or the close combat of those guys and the Lord, I'm going to get armor saves against. So I don't really need the cover, but it's always nice to play as if you do need it. And when we come to a segment that I decided to talk about that, I will. This guy I tried to play a little bit behind. Maybe he's going to get some cover from this. I don't know exactly what Tom Riddle's line of sight it looks like, but we'll talk about that when Tom comes to shoot, and we'll see how that goes. I placed my Master of the Forge out front to cover my stern guard, so he's going to be the closest model, so he'll take wounds first with his 2+ save and hopefully tank for them. And they're pretty decent shooting, so I'm like that. And then I placed my Razorback just kind of here in the center. It's kind of a bid to see if I can get that guy, that Annihilation Barge, to just come up and come out in the open. I did not actually pre-check range. When I go to the deployment segment where we talk about stuff, one thing I could do is if that guy is at least over 30 inches out from my Razorback, he'll only get to snap shoot against my Razorback. Like I said, I want to give an overview of the game to Tom and kind of give him and make sure that he gets some at least a base of everything. So I'm not worrying too much about it. All right. So there's three other things we're going to do before the game begins. One, either one of us can choose to say I would like it to be night fight. And if either one of us does, then on a roll of a 4+, the stealth rule is in effect for everybody. And the stealth rule basically means you add +1 to your cover save. So Tom, hearing that, would you like to have the stealth rule in effect? Would you like to try and have night fight on the turn one?
No.
Okay, so you're not going to roll for it. I don't really care. I have pretty good armor saves. Just being pretty good at this game, he may be out 30 inches on that guy. I don't know exactly. We'll see what happens. It's going to be close. So I'm not terribly worried about it. So I'm going to go ahead and say no, I don't really want night fight either. So we have no night fight. Now, right before we seize the initiative, we're going to roll to see what all these objectives are. So the first thing we'll roll for is the 4. So Tom Riddle, go ahead and roll a d6. And if you roll a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that's where the number 4 will be. 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is the 4. Now let's do the same thing for the 1. Same thing, but you're re-rolling. This becomes the 5 now. You re-roll 6. Or re-roll 4s. Sorry, re-roll 4s. So 1, 2. So this is, or was that the 2?
2.
Okay. So that's worth 1 victory point. Okay. Now one of the 3s. 1, 2, that's a 3. Okay, there's a die right in front of you. So now it's a D3 instead. We're doing the other 3, so it would be the 3 over here now. And now a D2. So 1, 2, 3 for that one to be. Well, they're both 2s. I'm sorry, we don't need to roll anymore. Okay, so those are both 2s. So now we know where the objectives are for point value. So currently I have a 4 and a 2 and a 3, and you've got. Well, you're too far out, but you have the 3s close by. So that kind of gives you a look-see as to how you would need to move. This becomes important against certain armies because, let's say that if it was I was a Tau army and I was just going to stand here and shoot you, Tau are very shooty-oriented army, it could be to my advantage to have these objectives here. I wouldn't ever have to come out and fight you. But let's say that I had ended up getting the 1 over here, and you had the 4 over there, over here, something like that, then I would have to actually bring guys out to get those objectives, or else maybe you would be able to just sit on objectives and win the game based on that. Anyhow, the last thing we're doing is we're going to roll to seize the initiative. If I roll a 6, I seize the initiative against you. I do not. I rolled a 3. So it will be Tom's turn 1. Go ahead and go, Tom. All right, so it's going to be Tom Riddle's first movement phase. Now, he has a couple of different things move a couple different ways. These guys are beasts or cavalry, so they have a movement of 12. And like I said, they ignore difficult and dangerous terrain, so they're never slowed by it. So when you go to measure a basic model, you always try and measure from the front, whatever your movement is, from the front of the base, and then end up with the front of the base right at the end there. Standardly in Warhammer 40,000, you get either, most infantry and stuff moves 6 inches, and 6 inches or other things can move up to 12 inches. That's basically, it's either 6 or 12. A couple exceptions to that is anything that's in like a difficult terrain situation where these guys are split onto multiple levels, they could do a difficult terrain roll, which is 2 dice, and then they pick the highest, and that's how far they'll move. So they could move anywhere from 1 to 6. Vehicles have the choice. They can either move 6, 0, 6, or 12, up to 12. Anything from 0 to 6 is called combat speed. Anything from 6 to 12 is cruising speed. But a skimmer moves from, it moves anything from anything 6 or less, they're considered to be, still have moved, they're still moving the combat speed, but they for shooting purposes, are only count as moving, or only, they count as stationary, so their weapons can shoot normally. Because regularly a vehicle can only fire, any vehicle that moves from, moves 6 inches or less, combat speed, can only fire one weapon normally, and then has to snap shoot all other weapons. And if they were to move cruising speed, which is over 6 inches, up to 12 inches, they have to snap fire all their weapons. But a skimmer gets the benefit of, if it moves 6 or less, it counts as being stationary for firing. And if it were to move over 6, it still gets to fire one weapon regularly, I believe. I'll double check on that. If it were a fast skimmer, then it can move, a fast vehicle, it can move over 6 and still fire one weapon normally. And if it's a fast skimmer, I believe it can fire two weapons. Normally. So, Tom's going to go ahead and move all of his guys, and we'll come right back. Alright, a quick correction. I was looking at the rule book. Skimmers don't actually get a benefit from moving and not any kind of benefit for shooting. It's only fast vehicles, and the way it works is a fast vehicle that moves at combat speed can fire all of their weapons, so that would be 6 or less. And anybody who moves at cruising speed, so 6 or more, up to 12, can fire two weapons at full ballistic skill. All other weapons have to snap shoot. So this guy still counts as a regular vehicle, even though he's a skimmer. So if he moves 6 or less, he can fire. If he moves, stays stationary, he can shoot both his weapons at regular ballistic skill. If he moves 6 or less, he can fire one of them, and the other will snap shoot. If he moves over 6, up to 12, both of them will snap shoot. So. I'll come back after doing that. And that, by the way, if you guys are watching this right after you watch my bat rep, I totally cheated. Poor Paul on that. All right, so you moved. Let's talk about where you moved. This guy scooted around, and I've already actually pre-measured off of camera, and pre-measure, of course, is allowed at any time. He's just, like, barely, he's within an inch. It's 24 to, like, right about there, so... It was a good call, and he could have pre-measured any time. For instance, knowing, let's say that he was to move 6 inches and finds that he's out of range, he could have, in fact, moved more, would have had a snap shoot, but at least would have put himself in range to shoot this tank if that's what his target was. He could, of course, shoot at something else. These guys moved up over here a little bit. I don't know, did you move your full 12 inches? Or?
I did.
Okay, so they moved all the way up, full 12 inches. They're trying to get closer. They're going to be out of charge distance. I already pre-measured. They're about 12 to right there. So they can't even attempt to charge. So they may do what's called running, which I'll explain here in just a minute. These guys off camera rolled a four and a two or something. The high number was a four, so they moved forward 4 inches. And one thing that's nice about them is that they are a rapid fire sniper. Most sniper weapons are like a heavy weapon. They have a longer range. These guys have a shorter range, only 24 inches, but they can still move and shoot 24 inches. Just came down the steps with the warriors and the overlord, and then came through that that structure there with the immortals. So we're up to shooting phase. So, like I said, most all of your weapons have a 24-inch range. So you get to pre-measure before you try and target stuff. If a guy is not in range to shoot, you have the option with all of these, with basically everything, even this guy, to do what's called running or going flat out in his case. Okay. Now a run is a 1d6 roll, and whatever the result is, that's how much further forward you go. Okay. So you could do that instead of in lieu of shooting. Now, tactically, a real quick tactical one is if you do that, it might actually put you in range of me moving and then being able to shoot more effectively against you. So that might be something you would take into account based on pre-measuring and whatnot. So you just measured. It looks like these guys probably have 24 inches to... are within range of a couple of these guys. Now here's an important thing about taking casualties and shooting. You can only kill what you're in range of. So let's say that, for instance, this unit right here is going to, this warrior unit is going to shoot me, and that's about 20, 21, here we're going to, sorry, I can't. Okay, so he's got it pre-measured out. Now he's measuring, what he wants to do is it's actually 24 inches. You actually want to measure from the front, it's the same way as with movement, from the front of the base of the model to whatever target unit. So every one of the guys in this tactical squad is within range of his closest guy, which is just fine. So all of them will get to shoot. But you do want to measure also your furthest back guys to see if they're within range of any of my guys to be able to actually shoot. And from the front of their base to the front of mine, keep going out a little bit so that it looks like your back fellow right there is actually out of range. Check this other guy over here, right next to him. And these are things that you get, yeah, he's within range. So you just get used to doing this when you're actually doing it on the fly and playing in a game or whatever. Sorry about that, I got two sets of batteries that were low battery, I had to change it out. So, as we were saying, he's got nine guys in range to fire at these tactical marines if he wishes with that unit. Another thing that's important is line of sight. If guys are out of line of sight of regular shooting weapons, they can't take wounds, and if your guy cannot see any of the target unit that you're shooting with the rest of your unit, he cannot shoot. So that's important to get down and have a model's eye view. So it's maybe a little hard to tell with the small camera, but this guy can definitely see the tactical marines, which was what he was measuring earlier. This guy right here can see one of them over there on the edge. It's a little hard to tell. This guy, again, can see one on the edge. That guy can as well, and so can this guy. So these death marks can, in fact, at least see one guy in the unit, so they can shoot at it, but it's possible, yep, it looks like to me that this closest guy here in the corner right there, that guy, it cannot be seen by any of the death marks. So if the death marks were to shoot at me, and they were to, say, kill four guys, if they have range to all of them, this guy could not be taken as a casualty because he's out of sight. Now, there's exceptions to that, blast weapons and some other things, but we don't need to really go into that right now. So what are you going to shoot with? That we kind of got an idea of some of the basic rules of shooting.
I'm going to shoot with the snipers.
The snipers. Okay, so the death marks. So you have five death marks. Now go ahead and check your range again just to see where we're at as far as check your closest guy. So your closest guy has 24 inches, which will get you to just short of this guy. So this guy can't be seen. That guy's out of range. So three guys are targetable.
Okay.
Now check this back guy to see if he has range at all. If he's got range to the closest model. Yes, he does. Now, we're doing a little bit of extrapolation based on the levels of terrain here and stuff like that, but close enough that he can shoot, and it's friendly game. I'm not terribly worried about it. So, you have four guys who can shoot. Oh, let's not use that die because we're trying to keep track of those. So, okay. Grab some dice off the table over there. We've got five shots that can kill a possible three guys. Now, ballistic skill. Whatever the ballistic skill of your guy is what their target number needs to be to hit. And it's an equation of 7. So if you take your ballistic skill and subtract it from 7, that's the target number you need. So their ballistic skill, 4. So what do you think they need to hit?
Threes.
You are correct. That's how the equation works. Now the only exception to that is a 1 will always fail and a 6 will always hit.
Okay.
So go ahead and roll 5 dice. You need 3s. So 5 hits. Nice roll. Now, you didn't roll any 6s. That was the important thing with the snipers. If you'd rolled a 6, you could have chosen where the shot was going to go.
Okay.
But no 6s, so they're all going to just hit starting with the front guy.
Okay.
Now go ahead and roll the wound. You're a sniper. You have a sniper roll, so you always wound on a 4+. So 4+ and 6s will be cover saves. This guy is a cocked die. Now let's talk about how we do cocked dice.
Okay.
Some people here at BTP will play anything cocked, go ahead and re-roll it. The way that I like to do it is if you can put a die on top of it, and if the die will stay that's on top of it, you can keep the roll. If the die rolls off, like you saw me just have, you re-roll it. So that would be a re-roll. So go ahead and re-roll that die. And that does cause a wound. So you have, I don't remember if that was a 4 or not.
It was a 4.
So there's 4 wounds right there for me. So I'll take 4 saves. Now, as you'll recall, I still only had one guy out of line of sight, one guy out of range. So only 3 guys are eligible to be taken as casualties. When I roll these armor saves, well, I'm now rolling armor saves, so whatever my armor save value is, I need to equal it or exceed it. So I have a 3+ armor save, so I only fail on ones or twos. And then it, also, casualties are always taken from the closest model to the target that's shooting at me. So that thing's knocking that thing over. So from those guys, from those death marks, the closest guy is this guy. And then these guys are pretty close to equidistant. Now I'm going to roll all my armor saves together because all of them are the same. And there's no character in there that I can possibly look out or off of. Wow, that was great. What a good roll. So I roll a 2 1s and a 2. So I'm actually going to lose 3 guys, including my heavy weapon, which is awful. So those guys are all dead. Now at the end of any phase where you lose 25% of your unit, you take what's called a morale test. And that's based off their leadership. You'll roll 2 dice, and you'll have to roll equal to or under their leadership, or else they run away. Their leadership is 8. They've lost 25%. So what he's going to try to do is he's going to try to kill the rest of my unit off, actually. So you're going to re-need to check range because some of the closest models were gone.
Yeah.
So check from your furthest back guy, actually.
Furthest back guy.
The ones that are furthest back are the ones you get to check. So he's out of range. So check the guy next to him. That guy are you on the front of your base?
I skipped those two and went to the...
Yeah, he's probably in range. So it looks like, check the one to behind him there. That guy's probably out of range. So it looks like you've got about three out of range. No, I think this guy actually had range.
This guy had range.
So yeah, that guy maybe doesn't. You might want to check him.
I think he was bit.
Oh yeah, he's out. He's out. So you've got 4 guys out, and you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in, and I don't know, the 6th guy. Yeah, the 6th guy is in probably. So go ahead and roll 6 dice because their weapon has 24-inch range and.
Okay.
And then,
I'll do a couple more.
Okay. So it's gonna be the same equation again. They have ballistic skill 4. Now, rather than them being sniper weapons where they always wound on a 4+, these guys have a weapon. These guys have strength 4. So you're gonna compare it to a person's toughness. The toughness of my guys is 4. So if the roll is equal, if your strength is equal to the toughness, you need a 4+ roll. So it's 50% chance to wound. If, for instance, your weapon was 1 higher strength, or my toughness was 1 higher, you need 1 higher either way. So if your strength was 3, for instance, and my toughness is 4, you would need a 5. But if your strength was 5 and my toughness is 4, you would need a 3. The equation, and that's how that equation works. Then it goes one step higher. If your step is, let's say that your strength was 6 and my toughness is 4, you would need 2s. Or vice versa, if your strength was 3 and my toughness was 5, again, an equation of 2, you would need 6s to wound me. And then it goes, if as long as your strength is 2 higher than the others, you're always going to wound them on 2s. 1s will always fail to wound. And if my toughness is double your strength.
This is too many numbers.
All right, it's too many numbers. Tom's having a hard time. Go ahead and roll. You need 4s. 2 wounds.
Okay.
So 2 armor saves. I again fail 1 of them. So this closest guy will die. I'm down to one guy alone. He stands alone. All right, next unit.
Okay, and then this is the... So I guess I can shoot with him, right?
You can shoot with him.
So yep. 45-degree angle. I didn't quite get him.
Yeah, no, you're probably fine on the 45 if you wanted to, say, shoot at this tank. I assume that's what you want to shoot at.
Yeah, that's what...
Okay, so you moved 6 inches, so the weapon, the underslung weapon, which is the weaker of the two weapons, that's the one you'll want to make snap fire.
Okay.
So it would only hit me on 6s. But the nice thing about Necron Tesla weapons is that a roll of a 6, which will hit me, also produces a two free hits. So if you actually roll, it's 2 shots, strength 6.
Okay.
So go ahead and roll those. If you roll a 6, which you didn't, you would have produced 2 extra shots. No big deal. Now, the main weapon, which is strength 7, 4 shots, and it's also twin link, which means you get to re-roll. And this guy has ballistic skill 4. Basically, your whole army has ballistic skill 4. So 1 6. And 1 hit, go ahead and re-roll those 2 1s because it's a twin link weapon. So 1 will stay a miss, that 2, but the 4 will hit. And then because you rolled a 6, you get to put 2 extra dice in. So put that die in and get 1 more die. And those are the number of hits you've caused.
Okay.
Now, your strength is 7, and my armor is 11. So you need to get a 4 to glance me and a 5 to penetrate me. So that's a cocked die, probably. Yep. So go ahead and re-roll that one.
Okay.
So it glances me, And that was an extra die, but that, yeah, but
that one, was this one good?
Yeah, that was a four. So that's two glances and a pin. So then what you're going to do is you're going to check for cover saves. My vehicle, if it were obscured from the fire by 25% or more, and for me personally, the way that I go pretty lenient on this rule with my opponents, because you know a lot of times they mean to, even if it's not exactly 25%, and you just, I mean, are you going to get your protractor out and really measure? I mean, are you going to really argue with somebody about that? No, I mean, just give them a cover save. But in this case, this guy doesn't get any kind of cover save. He's wide open. So it's just going to do two glancing hits and one penetrating hit. So go ahead and roll what the penetrating hit is. It doesn't really matter in this case because you cannot blow my vehicle up. So it's not going to do anything to the occupants, and my vehicle will be destroyed either way because a penetrating hit causes causes a hull point loss and an additional effect. Okay. And then there's also two other hull points that you've taken off for a total hull points of three.
So what am I rolling for?
You're rolling to see what the penetrating hit will do to the vehicle. Okay. It does a one, which would shake the vehicle. Normally, if my vehicle were still alive, that means that on the following turn, it would have to snap shoot its weapon. It doesn't matter because the vehicle has been destroyed. But because you did penetrate me, my passengers have to roll a leadership check, which is the same thing as a morale check. It's similar to a morale check. It's based on your leadership. And if I roll equal to or under, my guys can act normally. If I fail it, then they have to snap shoot because the vehicle was damaged.
Okay.
So here's their roll for that. They rolled a 12. That's lovely. So they are snap shooting. Also, any time that a vehicle is destroyed and passengers have to get out, unless they are fearless, they have to roll what's called a pinning check, meaning that they were pinned down because enemy fire made them like hunker down. So it's again another. It's based on their leadership check. So nine or under. I'm not rolling there again. That's terrible. So they are pinned and snap shooting. A pinned unit will snap shoot normally, so it doesn't matter whether one way or the other. If I hadn't gotten the other effect. But I'm going to go ahead and indicate that my vehicle has been destroyed. I'll pull some pieces off because I've magnetized my stuff. It's fun and magnetized. Yay. Then all of my passengers will have to get out of one of the hatches. I have a rear hatch and two side hatches on this vehicle. And they'll have to stay completely, their bases will have to stay completely within 3 inches of one of the hatches and maintain coherency. So I'll go ahead and get them out and then we'll come right back. Okay, so they've all gotten out. They're all within 3 inches. The guy that I have laying on my side, he's on purpose laying on his side to show that the unit has been pinned. So that means a pinned unit on the following turn cannot move and always will shoot snap firing, and they cannot assault either. Effectively, they just get to, they're hunkering down, and they're just kind of like shooting their shots above their head, just wildly trying to fend the enemy off. So that's what happens to them. You do have two units left. You have your Immortals and you have your Wraiths. Now, we already determined the Wraiths are out of charge distance. What you can do is called run, which allows you to get closer and or would make it so you could move up behind one of these things to get a better cover save or anything like that. You don't actually need to do that with them because their invulnerable save is better than their cover save. Any cover save could be, but it might be advantageous to get you closer or further away, because you don't want me to be able to charge you in return.
Uh-huh. Could you do a cover save and a...
No, you only can ever... You can only make one kind of save, either armor, cover, or invulnerable. It's always the best of the three of them. The only exception to that is what's called a fill no pain, but it's not a save. It's something different.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah. So they could run. And then that unit over there, you could check to see range. You're probably out of range, so you're probably going to want to run with them as well. You're going to go ahead and pre-measure. 24 inches ends up like right about there, which is outside. Would have been in range of two of these guys, but they decided to die. Also, I forgot to say, destroying this gives you first blood. So you get that victory point from having first blood because you blew up a vehicle first, or blew up a unit.
All right, so with running these guys, what do I do to...
You roll a die, and that's the distance in inches that they move. So they did move an extra 5 inches.
Okay.
And you're still going to try and maintain coherency.
Maintain coherence.
Yeah. Did you want to run with these guys as well?
They're like, can they like, they don't have to, can, so they can kind of just leap over the terrain because they're not.
Uh-huh. Yeah. They're not slowed by it.
They're not slowed by it. Yeah. Then I'll run with them.
Go ahead and roll with them. 2 inches. So he's going to move them 2 inches, and those guys over there 5 inches, and we'll come back to the beginning of my turn. One other thing I forgot to do is I still have this one tactical, lone tactical marine left. He needs to make a morale check because he lost 25% of his unit. So he passes that on a 6, so he'll act normally. He doesn't care that his 4 battle brothers were killed. Or maybe he does. Maybe he's very angry and decided I need to stick around so that I can kill them. His enemies, you know, whatever. All right, my movement equation is pretty simple. I don't have a tank anymore. These guys are pinned, so they can't move. My single tactical marine moved up. I was thinking about maybe move behind this wall and hiding, but the death marks are high enough above it that they can still see him. So he's going to try and move up and use this wall to at least give him some cover for a turn or so, try and hide out, and maybe later in the game, last ditch, go and run to an objective or something, depending on whether or not he survives. The Stern Guard and the Master of the Forge just came forward. They've got about a 5 or 6 inch charge to get these guys, but I am going to shoot first, so I may kill the closest guy off and have a longer charge. I moved this guy over here. He came 12 inches. He's a fast skimmer, so he still gets to fire two of his weapons while moving up to that distance. He's going to try to either take shots at these guys or take shots at those guys or maybe this guy. It just kind of depends on how their shooting goes. So I'm going to go with my other shooting here, and we'll go from there. Okay, so we'll start with the Stern Guard and their unit. We're going to go ahead and shoot these guys. The Master of the Forge has what's called a servo harness. It gives him a twin-linked plasma pistol and a flamer. And because I am playing Salamanders, Salamanders always get to re-roll their flamer wounds. So he gets to shoot two weapons because of it, and he has a twin-linked plasma pistol and a twin-linked flamer. So we're going to go ahead and fire them first. Here's the flamer. This is the flamer template. It's 8 1/4 inches long, and whatever goes underneath it, you go from the edge of his base and see how many models you can place it over. And whatever you place it over, that's how many hits you get. So he can place it over two guys. You still have to have a line of sight, by the way. So it's lucky that this guy's tall. So if he was like really short, I wouldn't be able to hit him. But since he's tall, I can. Since I can see him. So I hit two guys. There's toughness 4. I'm strength 4. So it will be forced to wound. But I get to re-roll the wound if I fail the wound because of the Salamander chapter tactics. So here, and this is to see how many you hit. So I don't have to roll the hit. So I wounded once, did not wound the other, but I get to re-roll. It still rolled a 3, which is not enough. So you'll make one armor save. So okay. Go ahead and roll a die. And a 3+, roll on the screen there. Make sure. So he takes a wound. So the closest model will take a wound. He has 2. Here's the plasma pistol. It needs he's ballistic skill 5, so he needs a 2 to hit, 2 to wound you, or 2 to hit you, sorry. And then he does need a 2 to wound you because it's a strength 7 weapon against your toughness of 4. So off the table, always re-roll off the table. That's where we play. So that does wound you. It's an AP2 weapon, so you have a 3-up armor save that it destroys, but you also have a 3+ invulnerable save. So you just go ahead and roll, and on a 3+, you're okay. You're okay. Now the rest of the unit, they're going to fire, and we're going to... Do I want to try to charge here? I'm just outside 5. It's going to be 6-inch charge if I don't kill that guy. If I do kill that guy, the next closest guy is 7 through difficult terrain, which means I would have to roll... On two, you always make your charges on 2 dice, and that's the distance you roll. And if you're going through difficult terrain, which would be this thing, and we could call this is probably a level, so it'd actually be more than that. So this guy might be the closest guy. So if I kill the closest guy, it's like a 9-inch charge instead of a, which would be the same thing as if this was not a level. It would be 7 minus 2. Questions: Do I think I can beat those guys in close combat? Yeah, I'm gonna try and beat these guys in close combat, so I'm actually not going to shoot them anymore. I'm going to just try to charge. These guys here are going to see if they have range with their bolters to shoot those death marks. No, they don't. They're out of range, so they don't. This guy right here will go ahead and fire into... How many death marks can I see? I can see all the death marks, but the death marks... we'll probably get cover for my missiles, or I can shoot my missiles at this thing and try to do something to that. Okay, so I'm going to actually try and shoot at this thing. I think this thing will do more damage to me than the death marks will. The only weapon that I have that can hurt it is the missiles. The missiles have a strength, they're strength 8, there's two of them, against his armor 11 normally, but with quantum shielding 13. So it's ballistic skill 4, so I'll need a 3 to hit you, and then I will need a 5 to glance you, and 6s would penetrate you. You are a skimmer. A skimmer has a rule called jink. Anytime that anybody's going to shoot at you, you can decide to do what's called jinking. And once you do it once, you're doing it for the rest of the turn. It gives you a 4+ cover save, even if you're out in the open. But it means your weapons have to snap fire on the following turn. So, I'm going to shoot my two missiles at you. Would you like to jink? Now, the consequences of this are either you snap shoot next turn, which rolls of a 6 to hit are good for you because you have Tesla weapons.
Yeah.
Or, and you're still a twin linked on this good on the top weapon. Alternatively, you may just say, go ahead and do your worst. Because right?
It's AP 13.
It's hard for me to get through your armor. I need a 5 or a 6 once I hit to do anything to you. And if I don't roll a 6, you're still going to be armor 13. If I roll 5s, you just take a hull point off this guy. We're playing him as if he has 3 hull points. I'm not, like I said, I don't know for sure if he has 3 or 2.
I won't jink.
You're not going to jink. Okay. So, I need 3s to hit. That was a good choice. I missed. So, I don't do anything. That was lovely. Okay. We're done with my shooting phase. I don't have anything else to shoot. I'm sorry. I'm going to do this. This tactical marine's going to run. He runs 5 inches, which is what I wanted. So, he's going to run up here past this guy. Let's see. If he goes right here, those death marks probably can just still see him and shoot him. Yeah. I'm worried that those guys over there are going to be able to get to him. We're going to go right here. Yeah, you can't see me there. All right. So we're going to go right there with him, and then hopefully you don't have enough range or line of sight over there. You probably will, and I'll probably just die anyway. But it's an attempt. Here, these guys need a 6, I think I said, on 2 dice to charge you. You don't have any shooting or any. Regularly, if you're charging somebody and they have shooting weapons, they get to do what's called overwatch, which is they're basically going to snap fire all their weapons at you, trying to do damage to you. But Wraiths don't have any, so I'm going to just try to charge you here. That's cocked. This is awful. Okay, good. That would have been awful. I'd rolled a 2, and then I had to re-roll that 6, which is what I needed. So it could have been 1, 2, or 3, which would mean I failed my charge. If I fail my charge, I just stand still and I don't do anything. I got an 8, so I'm going to move. First thing I do is I always move my closest model to your closest model in the shortest distance possible. So he goes and faces up with that guy. Then everybody else moves the maximum distance. So I had to switch cameras. So everybody else is going to move the maximum distance, 8 inches in this case, towards you, trying to base. There's a set of criteria. First, they're going to try to base an unbased model while maintaining coherency. Second, they'll try to base a model who's already based. And finally, if they can't do that, then they'll just try to get as close as they possibly can to the rest of the unit maintaining coherency. So with an 8, this guy's not going to quite base on that guy. He can't reach anybody else, so he's just going to kind of come up here, and this guy will do the same. They're all going to come up here like that. Now, at initiative, now we go through the initiative steps, and I have 4 guys here that are initiative 4. You have 4 guys that are initiative 2, and I have this guy who has an initiative 1 weapon. So my 4 guys with their initiative 2, or 4, sorry, will strike first. At your initiative step, that guy, my bad. One more. At initiative 4, at your initiative step, you'll make a pylon move. And a pylon move is a 3-inch move that's exactly the same as your initial move. So you'll try to first base an unbased model. So that guy will base that guy. Then you'll try to base models who are already based. So in this case, since he can't reach he can't reach anybody else, he'll base on this guy. This is where models that you've made look cool and poseable are kind of a pain in the butt. And then finally, if they can't, they'll just pile in as close as they can get. So anybody who's within 2 inches of a guy who's based, so this guy's based, that guy's based, and that guy's based, these three are not, but they're all within 2 inches, get to strike. So all 5 of these guys get to strike. Now, on their profile, they have 2 attacks base, and because they charged, they get an extra die. So So they're eat. So I have five guys. They get three attacks apiece for 15 attacks. Now they have. Now they're going to use their weapon skill against you because they're striking in close combat. Now weapon skill, you compare to your opponent's weapon skill, and that tells you what you need to roll. If your weapon skills are equal, you need a 4. If your weapon skill is higher, you need a 3. If your weapon skill is lower, you need a 4 unless the opponent has a weapon skill that's a double plus 1. Effectively, you're pretty much always going to either need 4s or 3s. In this case, our weapon skill is the same. They're both 4s, so I need 4s to hit you. So I roll. This guy's cocked. So I re-roll it. A 3 didn't hit. So I'm going to pull out all my misses. That was pretty good. Pretty good hits. Okay. My strength is 4, and your toughness is 4. And this is the strength of the guy, or the strength of their close combat weapon that you're comparing to your toughness. But I'm just basically punching you and hitting you with my bolt guns here, or my combat knives, or whatever. So I need 4. So I wound you 4 times.
Okay.
So you'll roll those 4 dice, and on a 3+, you save. This is your armor save or your invulnerable save, both of which are the same. So you rolled a 2 and a 1. Now you can choose where it... In taking wounds, you always, again, have to take wounds from the closest model. Uh-huh. You can choose which closest model you want. This guy's already taken a wound. This guy is another one who's closest. It doesn't really matter for this situation, but it can in other situations. You always have to take the wounds on the same model once you start taking them on them until that model is destroyed. So you lose 2 wounds, so effectively you're either going to take a wound here, and then that guy will die, and then you'll take a wound there, or you take 2 wounds here. My suggestion is actually to take 2 wounds on this guy and let him die, because this guy right here already has a wound on him. I mean, it's pretty much 6s, but what's going to happen is at initiative 1, this guy gets to strike, and he has a weapon that is double your toughness. And a weapon that's double your toughness will do what's called instant death, which will kill all of the wounds that you might have. So these guys have 2 wounds, but each wound of his that he gets through will take out all the remaining wounds of a single guy. So I'd probably put it on that guy. So, I mean, it only has 1 wound. I mean, it doesn't matter terribly in this situation, but it's a good thing to keep in mind for future.
Okay.
Now it's your initiative 2. So you're going to do the same thing. You made your pile in. You pile into that guy because you can base him, and then this guy will get pretty close. It's a good idea when you're starting out to measure it. We're not going to do it here, but to try and measure those to get a feel for what 3 inches is.
Uh-huh.
So now you have 2 guys who are in base and 1 guy who's at least within 2 inches of a guy who's based. Your guys have 3 attacks apiece, base. They did not charge, so they don't get any extra attacks. But they have weapon skill 4, my unit, again, is weapon skill 4, so you need 4s to hit me. Four and then your strength, I believe, is 6. So you'll need 2s to wound me. Pretty sure of that. Let me double check. Go ahead and roll to see if you hit. Yeah.
Alright. Pull out the 1s and 2s and 3s, right?
1s and 2s and 3s.
Alright. Looks like 6 hits.
6 hits. Great. Okay, so 2 of them hit, 1 of them missed.
Okay.
And then now you're going to roll the wound. My toughness is 4. Your toughness is 6. You're 2 higher than me, so you need 2s.
Okay.
So anything 2 or better, any 1s, you miss. So 2 1s. So you've done 4 wounds to me. Yep. Now I have an option. I can either, this guy right here and that guy right there are based. I can either start taking saves on them, or I can start with my character. My character has a different profile. He has a different armor save. Also importantly, if I didn't want him to get hit, I would start on somebody else, and then if it came to him, which it would be 1, I would roll to see if I lose these 2 guys, and then I'd have to start trying to look out, sir, and have other guys jump up and take wounds for him at that point. He has 2 wounds, and he has a 2-up armor save. So, and you didn't roll any 6s, right? No, okay, you didn't roll any 6s. If you'd rolled a 6, you would do what's called rending, which it basically finds a gap in my armor, ignores my armor. So my guys would not be able to make saves against that.
Gotcha.
So on a two or better, he saves. Now, if I roll these dice, the risk is if I start rolling, and there's only 4 of them, if I start rolling, I have to choose to look out, sir, a number of wounds before I start rolling saves on him. Otherwise, all the saves are taken on him until he dies or makes all the saves. Either way. If I fail, and the risk is if I fail some saves and he dies, you're going to get my warlord, and he won't be able to do his attacks because his attacks haven't happened yet.
So right now I'm just, like, I'm not calculating the on-the-field points. I have 1 point for first blood, right? So if I got warlord, that kind of puts me ahead.
It would put you in ahead again, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, it is a risk either way. Now, the good part of the risk is it's a low chance. It's one. I have four dice. Statistically, if you had six dice, one of these statistically would roll a one, right? One in six.
Yeah.
So I have a pretty good chance of not rolling any ones, and certainly not of rolling two ones, which is what would kill the guy, right?
Yeah.
So what I'm thinking of doing is just going ahead and rolling on him because I think he's going to save. And if he does, it's a better save than these guys, and I save these guys for later. So I'm going to go ahead and do that, and we'll see what happens here. So I rolled two dice, and of course, I rolled a two and a one. So he's okay on the two, not on the one. He takes a wound, and he's down to one wound. Now I have to take the other two saves one at a time because he only has one wound left. And if I roll another one, he's dead. And let's say on the first one I rolled a one and he dies, then the final wound would go on to one of these guys. So one at a time. He's good on a three, and finally he's good on a four. Okay, so he took a wound, but he did survive to swing. Now he gets to swing at initiative one. He's already in base, so he doesn't have to move. He has base two attacks, and he charged, and he has what's called paired weapons. If you have paired weapons, you get an extra attack. And in this case, he has paired specialty weapons because of his servo harness. So he has four attacks. He's weapon skill four, so he needs fours to hit you.
Okay.
And one of the cool things is he's a salamander character. Salamander characters get to have a free mastercrafted weapon. So because he has a servo harness gives him a twin link plasma pistol. Because he's a salamander, he has a twin linked flamer. Because he's a salamander character, he has a twin linked servo harness. So it's mastercrafted. What it will do is I'll roll this, and then if I missed one die, one or more dice, I get to re-roll one of them to try and hit again.
Okay.
So here's his rolls. This one's a miss, and this was a cocked die, so I'll re-roll that. It's cocked again. Wow, I can't dash under that corner again. So he hit three times and missed once. Because he's mastercrafted, he gets to re-roll. He failed it still. All right, so he hit three times. Now his strength is eight because of his weapon. It doubles his strength, basically, so he's base four times two. And it's AP two weapon. So you're not going to get armor saves, but it's okay. You have invulnerable saves with them anyway. But anything two or better, I wound. So one, so I don't wound with that, but I do two wounds to you.
Okay.
So the important thing that's the painful thing about these is if you fail one of them, it has a high enough strength that it will insta-kill. It won't do one wound to your guys who have two wounds apiece. It will do two. It will do the full wounds to the guys. It will kill them off. But it doesn't matter. You go ahead and roll both saves together because your saves are the same no matter what. That one's definitely cocked. You've rolled a six on the other one. You're okay. Four and a six, you don't care. All right, so I took one wound, but I caused two wounds. So that means you lose combat by one.
Okay.
Regularly, what happens is you would then take what's called a break test, I think. They might have a different name for it. But you would roll, and you would roll whatever your base leadership is.
So even though Oh, you killed one of my things entirely.
Yeah, I killed him entirely. He had two wounds on him. I caused two.
Yeah.
And you caused one to me.
Yeah.
So I win by one. That means that you would roll your leadership minus whatever I won by, in this case, one.
Mm-hmm.
And if you roll that or under, you stay. If you fail it, then you would have to try and fall back. I'm darn near sure that these guys have a special rule called fearless. And fearless means that you never make that save. You always just stay in combat. So I'm going to double check to see whether or not they have fearless, and if they do, then you're okay. You just sit there, and we'll fight again next turn, which is to your advantage, because I had more attacks this turn than I have in the future. So checking the rules, they do have fearless, so they're totally fine.
Okay.
They don't care. So the last thing you're going to do is starting with the guy who charged. You'll do one more pylon move of 3 inches, trying again to base on base models first, and then base on models who've already been based. So those guys will pile in. None of your guys have to do that because I already did.
Okay.
And that is the end of my turn. So it'll be
now. I lost 25% of this unit.
No. Right? Yeah. Yes. But it wasn't from shooting. It wasn't out of close combat. You made your check. You made your check based on the losing the combat, okay. But you're fearless. So importantly, these guys are fearless, so if they had lost 25% in shooting, you wouldn't have had to make that check either. Because they're fearless.
Okay.
Now, against a regular unit, just for kicks, let's look and see what their leadership is. That's probably 10. Most of this army is 10. It is 10. So you would roll on, in the case of losing the fight, you would have lost by one, you would have rolled two dice, and nine or less, you would have stayed. Over that, you would have tried to run, in which case what we would do is called we would do an initiative check. I would take my top initiative, and you would take your top initiative, and we would add them to a die roll. And whoever got higher, if I got higher, since I'm the one who won and charged, I would run your guys down as they tried to run away. If that was me getting equal or higher. If you had rolled higher than that, you would just roll two dice or three, I think.
I'm getting overwhelmed by rules.
Okay, so we'll leave it. We'll leave that.
So this is done.
It's your turn too.
Okay.
So we're talking about the movement on these guys. He's still moving these death marks around. He rolled again for the difficult terrain. He rolled a 3 and a 4. So we were talking about if it's modeled that way, you try to do two levels. So here's a level up to 3, another level to 6. We're calling this one, which is probably about 5 inches, we're calling that up to 6. So what we decided to do is he's got 3 guys on the bottom ground, so he's going to move them up one level and over an inch, basically. And then the guys this guy who was already up here, he could just move 4 inches straight. This guy was over here. He moves 1 and then 3. We kind of inched him maybe a little bit, but he's up there. So that's kind of how you want to make movement through levels go. It's a little bit counterintuitive at first. One thing I was going to comment on camera, these guys who had been pinned, at the end of my turn, they'll stand up and they have the chance to act normally starting next turn. Anyway, he's doing the rest of his movement. All right, where did you move, Tom?
I moved the skimmer about 3 Uh-oh. Inches.
That's some wildness going on.
Ouch!
Wild, loud, crazy people. Silliness. All right.
Move the skimmer about 3 inches out here.
Okay, she kind of came out on flat ground.
As we talked about before, move these guys through the difficult terrain up here.
Okay.
And just move these guys 6 inches out.
Okay. All right, so we're to shooting. Where would you like to shoot? Now, you always want to try and get model eye view, so go ahead and pull that terrain out of your way there.
Okay.
Just as long as you can try and get it back in nearly the same place, it doesn't really matter. So check your line of sight there. You got range, but go ahead and see if everybody has line of sight.
That one,
for instance, definitely. Does this guy have line of sight?
No, but these N2 do.
The N2 do. All right, so he's got 2 guys that are going to shoot my poor little tactical marine there, and they do have range, so go ahead and roll for them.
Okay, so
Two dice.
Needing
3s, so both hit.
Okay.
Need to roll a 6. That would be the Tesla getting extra hits.
And
it's strength 5. So they need 3s to wound. Two wounds. So here's 2 armor saves for that guy. And of course, he rolls a 1 and a 2. No armor saves here. So he's dead. Silly dice. It's really not rolling. It's because my purple marines are angry I didn't bring the purple dice to roll for them. That's what I'm going to say, anyway. Could just be that I'm terrible at making armor saves. All right, what's next?
Let's throw the skimmer at the other, or the two flyers at each other.
Skimmer's just skimmer. I'm going to go ahead and jink. Go ahead and...
Okay.
You moved, so this guy underneath will have to snap fire again.
Okay, so that one
two dice.
Two dice.
Needs 6s to do anything.
Okay.
Nothing. And now the regular weapon.
2 dice.
4 dice.
4 dice.
Yep, it's twin linked. You hit 4 times, so okay. You don't need it. No 6s, though. So I'm armor 10, your strength 7, so 3s will glance me.
Okay.
So you did 3 penetrating hits, okay? So this thing will be very dead if it doesn't make these saves. It gets 4+ saves here. It made 2 of them and failed 1 of them. So go ahead and make... You did penetrate me, so you're taking a hull point off.
Okay.
And you also have an additional effect. Go ahead and roll. It is a 6. That is a pin. That is a immobilized. I am not open topped. And he is AP4, so he doesn't add anything to die roll. So I'm just immobilized. So I sit there, and I cannot move after this, and I am missing a hull point.
Okay.
And I also jinked, so I will snap fire next turn. So we'll put a 6 on him to remind us that he is immobilized. Alright, now he's checking the range on his death marks. Looks like that guy's in. Check the guy next to him. Next to him, yes. The other ones are prior. That guy was just barely in.
That guy was
will be
barely
out.
In.
So, two shots.
Yeah,
you got a line of sight.
So,
two shots. You are ballistic skill 4, so 3's to hit again. You get to choose your target with one of them.
Okay.
So the black die can choose a target. Now,
can I? So what's the one with the herald? The banner. Thing?
The banner is my sergeant. Check and see if he's in range to be eligible as a target, though.
Okay.
Because that's important. No, he's not. But the guy with the melted gun. Oh, you know the guy with the melted gun's out of range as well. He's right here. So you rolled a 6. You would get to call your shot, but you can only call your shots on regular guys, so it doesn't matter. So go ahead and roll. Yeah, it's close enough. Okay. Go ahead and roll. Again, you need 4 plus to wound me. 2 dice. Yeah. 4 plus to wound me. 6s will take away my armor set. 1 wound. Okay. There's a 3 on the other die if you couldn't tell on the camera. Here's my armor save. That's a cocked die, thank goodness. And an armor save. Man, this is awful. I do not roll armor saves. All right, so they're okay. No big deal. Now, this was a sniper weapon. And I'm not 100% sure in 7th edition, but in the past, if you took a wound from a weapon that was a sniper weapon, they also had the pinning rule, which means I would have had to take a pinning check to see whether or not my guys were like, oh, something came from somewhere, everyone get down on the ground. I don't know if that's the case or not. I can't remember. But in this case, he didn't cause a wound to me, so we're not going to worry about it. So you've done all your shooting. These guys could run if you want, or they can. I don't think that they have a line of sight to anything, so I don't think they can shoot at anything.
Yeah, I don't think they can either. So
now, if they have line of sight to this, they could try to shoot this guy. But it's probably a long shot.
No, and I think they're probably out of range. Like maybe these back two right here.
No, that guy's out of range.
Yeah.
So you're out of range. So you probably just want to run.
Okay. So roll one
die. Two inches. So he'll move 2 inches with those guys, and then we'll go to close combat. So he moves from the front of the base to the front of the base, just like that. Perfect. So he's going to move all those guys. All right. We've arrived at close combat. This is our close combat, of course. Same thing as we had before. We go initiative. So my initiative 4 guys are going to go, except for you have a whipcoil guy, don't you?
Yeah.
Yes, this whipcoil guy right here is based on these two guys. So these two guys actually are going to swing at initiative 1. So I only have 3 guys that will swing at initiative 4. So the 3 guys that are initiative 4, they have base 2 attacks, so a total of 6 attacks.
Okay.
Needing 4s to hit you and 4s to wound you. So statistically, that's this one over here is cocked, and I got 4 hits so far. Statistically, I should hit 3 times and wound like 1.5. I've hit 5 times, which is phenomenal. And needing 4s, 3 wounds. That was really good rolling. But you get three pluses, either your armor or your invuln. It's the same, doesn't matter. You failed 2 of them. That's no bueno. That's going to kill a whole guy.
Okay. So this guy, so I could take like 1 and 1, right?
Whichever you start on, you have to continue to take all the wounds on until they die.
Well, technically, right, these two aren't.
Right, but you have to pick a model, right?
Okay.
So you pick one of the guys in base, and he takes wounds until he runs out of wounds or the wounds run out. So I've done 2. So if I'd done 1, for instance, you could be like, oh, I start on this guy and take 1 wound on that guy, and then he survives, right?
Uh-huh.
But because I did 2, it will either kill him off, or if you start on him, it'll do 1 wound to him and then 1 wound to that guy. So it would kill him, and he'd have 1 wound. So because I did 2, it doesn't matter. But if I had done 1, then it would matter. Okay. So now at initiative 2, you go with your guys.
Okay. So
3 attacks apiece.
3 attacks apiece.
4s to hit me. And, oh, that was terrible. Only 1 hit.
Yeah.
And a 2 to wound me. And if you roll a 6, it's a rend.
Okay.
But your strength 6. So you do wound me. I'm going to take it on a regular guy.
Okay.
Not on my leader. And he makes his armor safe. So he's okay. Yeah, that's no good.
The melee has not been going my
way. Well, yeah, the melee didn't go your way with that unit for sure. I felt like I had fairly good chances, and really, like, me charging you was to my advantage, because mm-hmm. it robbed you of an attack, and it robbed you of being able to go where you want, and I was able to hit you with the unit that has my special guy, my special weapon guy. So his special weapon guy, he has base 2, extra hand weapon bonus, so 3 attacks, needing 4s, getting to reroll if I miss, that was cocked. I don't miss, so it doesn't matter, and then needing 2s to wound you. I wound you 3 times, so make 3 invulnerable saves.
Okay.
You made all of them, so you're okay. So, you lose again by 2, but it doesn't matter because you're fearless. So again, we just have the pile-in. So this guy is going to pile in over here. He's going to choose to not pile into the whip coil guy. We're going to just inch this guy. He's in base with that guy, but we don't want him to be falling over. But the more I could pile into the other guy, the less it... And I had a choice here, right? Because both of them had already had guys attached to him. The guys that were unattached could go either way. So I'm going to choose to go to the guy that doesn't make me go initiative 1. Oh, you know what? I forgot. These guys need a swing. I have 4 more attacks. Let's do that real quick. 4 more attacks. 2 hits. 1 wound. So 1 armor save. You rolled a 5. You're okay. Alright, so now it'll be my turn 2. So I'll go ahead and move and we'll come back. Alright, movement turn 4 for you, Tom. What did you do?
These guys were locked in combat. I moved these guys within range of flyer.
Okay. Skimmer.
Skimmer. I moved these guys. I once again got double ones, so I just moved them a little bit. They're outside of 12 inches of that far unit.
Okay.
And then I moved this guy 7 inches back, so where he's 3 inches of this unit, since it is
objective.
Turn 4.
Yep.
And he's still within range.
But he is snapshooting.
He is snapshooting.
Because he jinked last time. Which was to his advantage, because he did stop that glance from going in.
Yeah.
All right, shooting.
Alright, I am going to shoot with them.
So 5 shots?
5 shots on the flyer.
I will go ahead and jink. It doesn't really matter. That's not terribly important. It's not blocking the line of sight of anybody anymore. So you hit 3 times, but it's a whatchamacallit weapon, a Tesla, so it gets 2 extra free shots. Okay, so go ahead and pull those. Yeah, there you go. 5 hits, and you need 5s to do something to me. So you got 1 glance. So I did jink. So that is going to give me a cover save, which I'd fail. So it is a wreck. All right.
Okay.
Those guys.
Those guys are going to shoot at the...
Or did you want to shoot this thing first? Because it may... If you were to kill off the front 2 or 4 or something, you may be out of range. I don't know.
Yeah.
That is one thing that's kind of important. You always want to try and shoot with the thing that's furthest away. Oh, it doesn't matter. You can have range of the last guy, so...
So 2, 3, 4. So 5. None of them are rapid fire.
Yeah. So 5 shots from these guys.
5 shots.
Okay. 6 is the hit. We'll allow you to pick where you're shooting.
Okay. 1, 6.
Okay. 4 hits total. Where's your 6 going?
I will take out. There's a heavy weapon.
The melta gun.
Melta gun. Yeah.
Okay. So you'll put that wound on the melta gun. Go ahead. It does wound me, so I need to make that armor save on the melted gun guy. He's not a character, so he can't look out, sir. He, of course, dies like an idiot. Okay, now the other 3 saves. Or 3 wound rolls. Wow, 2. That's brutal. All right, so 2 guys will die, and I take an armor save on the other guy. I will go ahead and... If I go to ground, I get a 6+ cover save, but I'd be pinned. I'll just take the deaths and make 1 armor save, knocking stuff over, of course. That's cocked. And roll a 1. Jeez Louise, tactical marines, man. You were terrible tonight. Alright, well, the sergeant stands alone, so he'll have to make a morale test, but you still get to shoot that thing.
Alright.
2 shots from the bottom gun. Because it's, 2 shot. Tesla 2. So 1 hit, which causes 3, because it's Tesla.
Oh, okay.
And you need 2 to wound me. So 2 wounds. And I rolled a 1, of course. So he's dead. Things are looking grim. I have the Master of the Forge. He stands alone. Let's go straight to that and see if you just end it right now, which will wipe me out.
All right, so three attacks.
Yep, 4s to hit me. Oh, only 1 hit. Roll a 1. Roll a 1. Nah, he's dead. Good game, Tom.
Good game.
That was Terrible armor save. I'm glad you did you get a good feel for it?
Yeah. I mean the math sometimes was like, this is too much.
I did throw in a lot. More specific.
On later times.
Right. Cool. Well, so the way that Tom ended it here, we have he's holding that objective. Now, depending on the tournament, he wiped me out. So in some tournaments they'll say, okay, you count your points from there, and others they'll be like, you get the rest of your moves to try and get the maximum number of points. But effectively, I don't have any guys on the table, so for a fun game, I'm dead. He wins. Good game. We'll come back with kind of a overview in just a moment. All right, we're just going to take a quick little look here at Studio Rats, Skaven. Studio Skaven from Warhammer Fantasy. Now, what the Skaven, what I'm looking here is not necessarily the paint job or anything, but I wanted to look at the cool movement trays that we have. So we have it set up here where you can order and buy trays that will allow you to have your guys, your infantry blocks, stick together and be able to move as a block rather than having to move every single model, which can be a real pain in the butt in fantasy especially. So it's basically, it's magnetized, and then we have a plate on the bottom of the infantry model so that they can all be, you know, blocked up nice and whatnot. And, you know, that's service we can do for your entire fantasy army. So let us know if that's something you need.